The theme of this session is about casting down strongholds, and it will deal with spiritual warfare. We need to understand first of all why there is spiritual warfare. Who is fighting who? Which side are we on? Let's turn to Matthew chapter 12, a passage about the ministry of Jesus, which brings out the basic fact that there are two invisible spiritual kingdoms that are at war with one another. One is the kingdom of Satan, and the other is the kingdom of God. I imagine that most of us have no problem with the concept that God has a kingdom. Some of you might not be aware that Satan has a kingdom, but he does, and it's most important for us as Christians that we understand the nature of his kingdom and how it operates, because if we are in the kingdom of God through Christ, we are automatically at war with the kingdom of Satan, and it's very important for us to know it, to understand the nature of the war. So let's read this passage from Matthew chapter 12, beginning at verse 24. Jesus had just healed a man who was deaf and dumb by casting out the evil spirit that caused him to be deaf and dumb. Did you know that evil spirits cause people to be deaf and dumb? When Jesus did this, we read what happened. When the Pharisees heard it, they said, "This fellow does not cast out demons, except by Beelzebub, the ruler of the demons." They made a terrible accusation. They said, "He can cast out demons because he is in league with the ruler of the demons." Jesus answered and said, "Every kingdom divided against itself is brought to desolation, and every city or house divided against itself will not stand. And if Satan cast out Satan, he is divided against himself. How then will his kingdom stand?" So Jesus said very clearly, Satan has a kingdom, and it's not divided. Then he went on to say, "And if I cast out demons by Beelzebub, by whom do your sons cast them out? Therefore, they shall be your judges. But if I cast out demons by the Spirit of God, then the kingdom of God has come upon you." There, Jesus speaks about the kingdom of God. So in this ministry of delivering people from evil spirits, the clash between the two kingdoms is brought right out into the open. The invisible kingdom of Satan is represented by the demons, the invisible kingdom of God is represented by Jesus, and by those who continue his ministry in his name. I believe Satan practically fears this ministry of deliverance because of two things. First of all, it brings out into the open his invisible kingdom, and he much rather have it invisible. And second, it shows the victory and the supremacy of the kingdom of God over his kingdom. We are just starting with this passage to show you that the New Testament reveals clearly there are two invisible spiritual kingdoms at war with one another. The kingdom of God. The kingdom of Satan. For a brief description of the kingdom of Satan and its headquarters, we turn to Ephesians chapter 6, which actually is an absolutely key verse on this whole theme. Ephesians chapter 6. Paul says in verse 12, "For we do not wrestle not against flesh and blood, but against principalities, against powers, against the rulers of the darkness of this world, against spiritual host of wickedness in the heavenly places." Now, I would like to give our version of that verse. It is just our version only. for our wrestling match is not against persons with bodies. We are in a wrestling match. But we are wrestling persons, who don't have bodies. Well, that immediately causes us to adjust our thinking. Cause, we're not used to the concept of persons without bodies. Although there are multitudes of such persons in the universe. Then he says, in our version, against rulers with various areas and descending orders of authority. So, it's a very highly organized kingdom. There are rulers in this kingdom, each with a particular area of responsibility. And under each of those rulers, there are sub-rulers who are responsible for sub-areas in that kingdom. Now you might say, well, Satan was very clever to devise such an organization. That's not so. The truth of the matter is that he rebelled against God. Being in charge of one third of the created angels, brought his angels into rebellion against God with him, and were cast out of heaven, and simply set up a rival kingdom, keeping the organizational structure that they had when they were part of God's kingdom. So, he doesn't get any credit for this extremely clever organization. Our wrestling match is not against persons with bodies, but against rulers with various areas and descending orders of authority. Against the world dominators of the present darkness. And we deliberately used the word dominate, because the Greek word is a very powerful word. And I choose the word dominate, because God never dominates anybody. Wherever you encounter domination, it's something satanic. That's not how God rules people. But Satan's ambition is to dominate the whole world, not just some little part of humanity. Through a kingdom of darkness to dominate the whole world. And, because his kingdom is a kingdom of darkness, the people who are in that kingdom, for the most part, don't know what they're in. You see, the kingdom of God is a kingdom of light. If we're in the kingdom of God, we know where we are. But most of the people who are in Satan's kingdom don't know where they are, because it's a kingdom of darkness. They can't see. And then, going to the final phrase of verse 12, against spiritual host of wickedness in the heavenlies, or in the heavenly places. So, there are vast armies. The word host is Old English for army. Vast armies of satanic beings, persons without bodies, arranged in battle order against us. It's important that we know that. It will make a lot of difference in our lives if we realize what we are up against. Now we need to point out that Satan's headquarters, as stated here, are in the heavenlies. We have a lot of language in the church which speaks about Satan as if he were in hell. Hell is a place of confinement for wicked persons below the surface of the earth. My comment on that is, it will be nice if Satan were in hell, but he isn't. He's very much at large. He's very active, and his kingdom is in the heavenlies. Now most people will then begin to say in your minds, but I thought Satan was cast out of heaven. You're perfectly right, he was. Now is the key to understanding this, is that there is more than one heaven. This is absolutely essential. Actually, in the first verse of the Bible, it says, in the beginning, God created the heavens, plural, the earth, singular. So right from the first verse in the Bible, we have this revelation that heaven is plural. Now, there are two passages in the New Testament which brings this out very clearly. The first is 2 Corinthians chapter 12, verses 2 through 4, where Paul is talking about people he knew, who have had marvelous spiritual experiences. And he talks about one particular person who was caught up from the earthly level into the heavenly. And he says, he doesn't know whether he was in his body or not. This is what he says. I know a man in Christ who 14 years ago, whether in the body, I do not know, or whether out of the body, I do not know, God knows. Such a one was caught up to the third heaven. And I know such a man, whether in the body or out of the body, I do not know, God knows. How he was caught up into paradise, and heard inexpressible words, which is not lawful for a man to utter. Now, Paul says, this fellow Christian he knew was caught up into the third heaven. He also says, he was caught up into paradise, which would seem to suggest that paradise is in the third heaven. And since there, he heard the words of God. The third heaven would apparently be the dwelling place of God. One thing that I am convinced of is logic. If there is a third heaven, there must be a first and second. There never has been a third of anything without the first two. So, that scripture tells us there are at least three heavens. And that's what we believe. Another scripture is in Ephesians chapter 4 and verse 10. Speaking about what happened to Jesus in death and resurrection, it says, he who descended into hell is also the one who ascended far above all the heavens, that he might fill all things. So Paul says, Jesus ascended far above all the heavens. My opinion is, the third heaven is the heaven of God's dwelling place. It's the holy heaven. And remember that God dwells even above heaven. That is stated in many places. Then the first heaven I would suggest could be the visible heaven that we can see. The sun, the moon and the stars. So, in some way, there remains a second heaven, which is never called the second heaven, which is somewhere between the visible heaven and the heaven of God's being. Personally, I believe that's where Satan's kingdom is located. Somewhere or other, between God and us, is a hostile kingdom, which opposes us and seeks to hinder our prayers. And that's why sometimes we have to pray through. You understand? It's not that we are praying out of the will of God. It's not that God is unwilling to hear. But we have to penetrate a hostile kingdom in the heavenlies to reach God. This is a passage from the book of Daniel, which very clearly reveals that this is so. We will not read the whole chapter, but if you're interested, you will do well to read the chapter for yourself later. Daniel chapter 10. This chapter relates how Daniel set aside a period of 3 weeks for special prayer, and he did what we've come to call a Daniel fast. He didn't give up all food, but he only ate the plainest and simplest food, and he drank no wine, and did not eat any meat. And he was mourning before God on behalf of his people, Israel, who were captives of the Gentile Empire. And at the end of 3 weeks, a very glorious angel came to him with the answer to his prayer, which was a revelation from God of what will be the future of his people, which consist of Daniel, chapters 11 and 12. But the angel said to him, the first day you began to pray, your prayer was heard and I was sent with the answer to your prayer. But he said, it took me 3 weeks to get through, because somewhere between the throne of God and Daniel on earth, I was opposed by satanic angels. And I had to force my way through those angels. So it's very clear that at the time of Daniel, somewhere between God's throne and earth, there was this satanic kingdom. I believe it's still there. It was still there when Paul wrote Ephesians chapter 6 verse 12, which was at least 30 years after the death and resurrection and ascension of Jesus. In other words, whatever the situation was, it wasn't changed by the death and resurrection and ascension of Jesus. Jesus ascended far above Satan's kingdom, but Satan's kingdom still remained in place. And then the angel told Daniel, I've come with the answer to your prayer, and when I leave, I'm going to have to fight my way back through the same angels, and then I'm going to have to fight other satanic angels. And the angel that came to Daniel said, on my way here, the prince of the kingdom of Persia withstood me 21 days. So for 21 days, these angels were battling in the heavenlies. And he also speaks about kings of Persia. In the language of the King James, I understand the prince was the supreme ruler. The kings were sub-rulers. But they are all concerned with the kingdom, or the empire of Persia. which at that time was the largest and the most powerful empire on earth. It had 127 provinces. So Satan had one super angel who was responsible to him for the whole kingdom of Persia. But this super angel had other angels that were responsible for different areas within the kingdom of Persia. Now, when the angel had finished telling Daniel about this, he said, "When I go, I will have to fight again with the prince of the kingdom of Persia, and then, after that, I will have to fight with the prince of the kingdom of Greece." Now, why Persia and Greece? Because there were four Gentile empires that dominated God's people: Israel, and their land, and the city of Jerusalem. And the battle is always most intense spiritually, where God's kingdom's issues are focused. So wherever God is at work, you'll find that Satan will be at work also. His very name means the resister. He resists God's purposes and God's people. He can't help it. He is a slave of his own nature. There were four successive Gentile empires that dominated Israel: Babylon, Persia, Greece, and Rome. Now, in Daniel's day, Persia was still the dominant empire, but the next one to follow it would be Greece. And so we see that the spiritual warfare, in a way, relates to God's people, God's purposes, and in a sense, it's necessary to carry out this spiritual warfare in order for God's purposes for his people to be fulfilled. And Daniel is a marvelous pattern of somebody who, by prayer and fasting and intercession, changed the history of his people. Let's now read the passages that we have been quoting. Daniel chapter 10 verses 2 and 3. "In those days, I, Daniel, was mourning 3 full weeks. I did not eat any pleasant food. No meat or wine came into my mouth. Nor did I anoint myself at all, till the 3 whole weeks were fulfilled." The period of 3 weeks is emphasized. "Now the angel that came to him said various things." And then in verse 12, this is what he said: "Do not fear, Daniel. For, from the first day that you set your heart to understand, and to humble yourself before your God, your words were heard. And I have come because of your words. But the prince of the kingdom of Persia withstood me 21 days. And behold, Michael, one of the chief princes, came to help me, for I had been left alone there with the kings of Persia." So, somewhere on the way from God to Daniel, he was opposed by the prince of the kingdom of Persia for 21 days. And in the end, another angel of God, the archangel Michael, had to come and join in the conflict. If you read further on in Daniel, Michael is called the great prince, or angel, that stands up for the children of your people. That's Israel. So, as a matter of biblical interpretation, you find this helpful. Wherever Michael is on the scene, Israel is center stage in human history, because he's the particular angel that has the job of looking after Israel. And believe me, that is a tough job. Now, going on, he says in verse 20 of Daniel 10, "Do you know why I have come to you? And now I must return to fight with the prince of Persia." In other words, the battle is not over yet. "And when I have gone forth, indeed, the prince of Greece will come." That's the next Gentile empire. And you can understand, behind the history of these human empires, there are satanic forces at work that really are the explanation of what happens. You really cannot fully understand human history if you only look on the horizontal human level. Cause the real forces that determine the destinies of nations and people are in the heavenlies. And then he says in verse 21 of Daniel chapter 10, "But I will tell you what is noted in the scripture of truth. No one upholds me against these, except Michael your prince." Again, the archangel Michael. Then you go on to the first verse of the next chapter, which is part of the same message. "Also, in the first year of Darius the Mede, I, even I, stood up to confirm and strengthen him. There's a clear example of the intervention of angels in human history. Why did God's angels stand up for Darius? The answer is, because God's people Israel had been captured and enslaved by the Empire of Babylon. And Darius was the ruler of the Persian Empire that destroyed the Empire of Babylon and released God's people to return to their land, which was God's purpose. So behind all the human forces and the horizontal plane, there is a vertical plane, and there are angelic forces, both angels of God and angels of Satan, that are at work. And human history is to be explained by the interplay of all these forces. Now, why we're significant as Christians is because God has given to us, and us alone, the weapons by which we can intervene in this spiritual war. Governments have armies and weapons that will deal with other nations, but only the Christian Church has the weapons that will intervene in the spiritual realm in the heavenlies. And you understand, the one who wins in the heavenlies ultimately determines the course of history. So the most significant thing you can do in history, in a sense, is be an intercessor and pray through the spiritual issues in the heavenlies that will determine the history of nations on earth. See, Daniel is a perfect example. Now, as we said already, we are involved in this war. That's not an option. The only decision you can make is whether you will be part of the kingdom of God or not. If you're part of the kingdom of God, you are at war with the kingdom of Satan. That's not something you can decide. You just better get equipped and learn how to fight. Because if you don't, you're going to be a casualty. Now going back to Ephesians chapter 6. Paul immediately, after speaking about Satan's kingdom in the heavenlies, tells us, we better put on our armor, beginning in verse 13. Therefore, take up the whole armor of God, that you may be able to withstand in the evil day. And having done all to stand, Paul says, there's going to come an evil day. An evil day comes in the lives of every one of us. Whether we stand or not depends on whether we got the equipment that we need. And then Paul lists the armor, and it's taken from the battle armor of a Roman legionary in his day. This is the picture. There are six main items of armor, which we will look at quickly. Stand therefore, having your waist girded with truth. You have a belt that you wear around your waist, and it's truth. Having put on the breastplate of righteousness, you have a protection over your chest, which protects your heart and its righteousness. Not the righteousness of works, but the righteousness of faith. And then it says, having shod your feet with the preparation of the gospel of peace, you have sandals that protect your feet and enable you to march far and fast. Which Roman legionaries could do? Once the protection of your feet is the preparation of the gospel of peace, above all law, over everything else. Taking the shield of faith. This is a great big shield, shaped like a door, which can protect every part of your person from the arrows of the enemy. And then it says, take the helmet of salvation. What part of you does your helmet protect? Your head. What does your head stand for? Your thought life. And it is so important we know how to protect our thought life. God has provided a helmet. Here it's called a helmet of salvation. In 1 Thessalonians chapter 5 verse 8, the helmet is called the hope of salvation. Do you know what protects your mind? Hope. You've got to be optimistic. If you're a pessimist, your mind is open to the attacks of Satan. Take the helmet of salvation and the sword of the Spirit, which is the word of God, the spoken word of God. Notice, you got six items of equipment. All of them are defensive except the last one, the sword, which is a weapon of attack, but it only goes as far as your arm can reach. But the seventh weapon is the weapon, and it's in verse 18. Praying always with all prayer and supplication in the Spirit. Here is where we can reach out and assail Satan's kingdom in the heavenlies. It's with the weapon of prayer, in the spirit. So we have 7 items of equipment, 5 are defensive. The 6th is the sword, but the 7th is what I call God's intercontinental ballistic missile. What is it? All prayer. We can assail Satan's kingdom with the weapon of all prayer. Let's go back to Matthew 12. If the church will only start thinking, we would be undefeatable. It's important that we learn to think. We read in Matthew 12 about Jesus' answer about the 2 kingdoms. The next verse is very important. Matthew 12 verse 29. Or, how can one enter a strong man's house and plunder his goods, unless he first binds the strong man? And then he will plunder his house. This is in connection with the warfare of the kingdoms. The principle of the strong man. Jesus pictures a house with a strong man. A despot. A cruel ruler. Who has in his house slaves, all sorts of stolen goods. But he got everything under his control. And it's very difficult to go in and set his slaves free, or steal, get back his plunder. If you go in all the time you're trying to free his slaves, you're fighting off the strong man, and you may end up wounded. So Jesus says, that's not the logical way to do it. The logical way is to begin by binding the strong man. Tie him up, put a gag in his mouth. Then you can walk in and out at liberty. And help yourself to what you need, and set his captives free. This is a spiritual principle. If you want to be successful in any given situation, you got to discover who is the satanic strong man over this situation. Then you got to bind the strong man. Then you can do what needs to be done in the situation. But the principle is, first, bind the strong man. Then set his captives free. Satan's kingdom descends from level to level with persons, angelic beings, with areas of responsibility. And they come down, the lowest ones are pretty small areas. And generally speaking, you don't start at the top, you start where you are, and you learn the principles of warfare, and then you can move on. Until you're dealing with the strong man over a city, or even over a nation. But you don't normally begin there. So, if you have problems in succeeding in doing the will of God, in breaking through spiritually, maybe in your family, maybe in a business, maybe in a church, and somehow, things are not going the way you feel they ought to go, but you don't understand the problem. My suggestion is, in all probability, there is a strong man over that situation. And you will not be really successful until you deal with the strong man in the name of Jesus. You may have it in a business. You may be a Christian businessman. It may be that you really want to use your finance and your talents for the Lord. But somehow your business never really prospers the way it should. And just when you're on the point of breakthrough, you get frustrated. I want to suggest to you, there's probably a strong man over your business. I do not know exactly what it could be. It's not my job to know. It's your job to find out. What's the strong man over the United States? Because there are many forces in the nation. But I will say essentially, rebellion. The strong man over Britain is pride. Let's come to some of the weapons that we can use. First of all, prayer. These are a few scriptures about each. Matthew 18 verse 18. And following, Jesus is speaking. Assuredly, I say to you, whatever you bind on earth will be bound in heaven, and whatever you loose on earth will be loosed in heaven. That's a tremendous statement. The Greek actually says, whatever you bind on earth will be having been bound in heaven. So the moment you bind it on earth, it's bound in heaven. You see, we have the power to intervene in the heavenly realm. If we meet the conditions on earth, we can bind something on earth which is bound in heaven. Or, whatever we loose on earth, will be loosed in heaven. If a group of persons, a family, a community, even a nation, are bound by certain spiritual forces, if we meet the conditions on earth, we can loose them. And what we loose on earth, shall be having been loosed in heaven. In other words, Jesus says, you bind it on earth. Then when you look around, it's bound in heaven, see. In a way. We're not waiting for God. God is waiting for us. An attitude of passivity is hardly ever pleasing to God. But Jesus attaches some conditions. Again I say to you, that if two of you agree on earth concerning anything that they ask, it will be done for them, by my Father in heaven. The word agree in Greek, is symphonize, or harmonize. So attached to the promise of binding and loosing, is the condition of being able to harmonize. If two people harmonize in prayer, and ask for anything, they'll get it. But it's not easy to harmonize. I believe, the reason for that promise is because the only way we can harmonize, is by the Holy Spirit. And if we harmonize by the Holy Spirit, we will harmonize on what God wants. But it's a tremendous challenge, especially to Christian couples. If the husband and wife can harmonize, they get whatever they pray for. But it's not easy to harmonize. How many would agree to that? It's pretty easy to be almost in harmony, but musically, almost in harmony is excruciating. And you'll find that the devil will fight your harmonizing every way he can. Cause he's afraid of it. And then it says, we'll say. Thanksgiving is another tremendous weapon. Let me point out to you something very interesting about the ministry of Jesus. In John chapter 6, when Jesus fed the 5,000, in verse 11, it says, and Jesus took the loaves, and when he had given thanks, he distributed them to the disciples. Jesus did not pray. All he did was give thanks, and giving thanks over 5 loaves and 2 fishes made them sufficient to feed 5,000 people. And a little further on, in John 6 verse 23 it says, other boats came from Tiberias, near the place where they ate the bread after the Lord had given thanks. What released the miracle? Given thanks. And then, praise. Psalm 8 verse 2, God says, out of the mouth of babes and sucklings, his appointed praise, that he may silence the enemy and the avenger. Who's the enemy and the avenger? Satan. Why does he need to be silenced? What is he doing all the time? He's accusing us before the throne of God. Why doesn't God silence him? Cause God says, I've given you the weapons to silence him. In Acts 16, Paul and Silas were in prison, the maximum security jail, bound hand and foot, and at midnight, they prayed and praised, and God sent an earthquake that released the whole prison, contingent and opened every door. What released that earthquake? Praise, and then, proclamation. You see, Moses was called by God to go and deliver Israel out of Egypt. And he said, God, I don't have anything. God said, what is that in your hand? He said, that's just my shepherd's staff. God said, throw it down on the ground, and it became a snake. And Moses ran from his own staff. He didn't realize the power he had in his hand. God said to him, all you need to deliver Israel is that one staff. Go back and use it. And if you read the story starting in Exodus chapter 4, with that one staff, Moses wrested the rule of Egypt out of the hand of Pharaoh and took it over on behalf of God, and brought about the release of Israel. You say, well, I don't have anything. But God says, what have you got in your hand? A Bible, that's all you need. Just take that staff and stretch it out. How do you stretch out the staff? By making proclamation of what the Bible says about you. God is waiting for you with open arms. Please pray. Jesus, I know that you are God's only Son that came to earth to die for my sins. I receive you into my heart. I believe on you. I need you, Lord. Please, Jesus, come into my heart and change my life. I want to know more about you and our Father in heaven. Please send the Holy Spirit to me to be led. I pray in Jesus' name. Amen.
Somebody shout Jesus. Come on, shout Jesus in the room. We know what the power is. I need somebody to just shout Jesus. Yeah. Yes, yeah, shout it without an instruction. Somebody shout like you have a relationship. Hey, we know where the power is. God, we need power. We need your power. We need your power. There is power in the name of Jesus. There is power in the name of Jesus. There is power in the name of Jesus to break every chain, break every chain, break every chain. Come on, declare it. To break every chain, break every chain, break every chain. Let's say it. There is power. There is power. Come on. Say, there is power.
There is power
in the name.
In the name of Jesus.
Say, there is power.
There is power in the name of Jesus.
And it's here tonight. Say, to break every chain.
To break every chain. To break every chain. To break every chain.
Say, to break
every chain. Break every chain.
I need every hand to go up right here. There's an army rising up. Come on, army of the Lord, declare it. There's an army rising up. Hey. There's an army. Every chain, break every chain, break every. Let's step together. Say, there is power. Come on.